of intercession.
Pray in your
children, Lord Jesus. Any thoughts that are not of you, we hold them captive in the name of Jesus, and we cast them down and out right now, Lord. Right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Soto kerebekia. Those that are needing healing today, physical healing, emotional healing, right now, they receive their healing in the name of Jesus. As we are gathered together, as we are fixed on you, they receive their healing right now. Hallelujah. Sorobo shekerebekia basotoe. That when people, from the moment they drive into the parking lot, they, Father God, you are working in their hearts. You are working in their hearts. To the moment they walk through those doors, Father God, they just sense your presence. When they walk through those doors, Father God, and then leave later, they will not be the same. They will not be the same. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Keep praising, keep worshiping. Don't drop your worship. Don't drop your praise. Don't drop your worship. It's all about Him. Don't worry about what I'm going to say or do. Fix your eyes on Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, you are Lord. You are Lord, you are Lord, you are Lord.
Arms with other women and encourage and uplift.
but women that build up their husbands for those that are married. And for those that aren't married, they build up others. Women that are sensitive to the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Women that have a sound mind. Women that don't operate in fear, worry, or doubt. Women that get in the Word, in the presence of the Most High God. Sherebeki, I pray for their ears to hear and discern your voice, Lord. Women, go ahead, lift your voices and sing in the Spirit. Sing in the Spirit. Boldly sing.
That you would begin to tear down every high and lofty thing that has come against the women of this house. I pray for a spirit of unity to come over this house like never before. Father, raise up Holy Ghost filled women. Raise up Holy Ghost filled wives. Raise up Holy Ghost filled moms. Raise up Holy Ghost filled grandmothers that would begin to decree the inheritance of the gospel, that would begin to decree the inheritance of their children, that would begin to break the strongholds of generational curses. Father, I thank you that you would shake up the woman of this house and bring about sisters of purity in the name of Jesus, that the lions and the lionesses arise. Arise and shine, captive daughter of Zion. Shake off the bonds of your neck. Shake off your circumstance. We call you forth victorious in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, Jezebel will not have any influence over any woman. Father God, spirits of lust will not have any hold over any women. Spirits of manipulation and control will not have any hold over the women of this house. Father God, I thank you that you're raising up priestesses of the presence of Christ. Raise up female apostolic and prophetic unction. Father, we thank you, Lord God. Come on, women, I want you to shout. I want you to dance. I want you to make war for your family. I want you to make war for your children. Come on, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. Where are the women in this house? Come on, hallelujah. Come on, Reban Sole Remento, Samante Lebremesia. Your shout and your dance bring breakthrough for your family. Your shout and your dance bring victory for your home and your spouse. Hallelujah. 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 Glory to the blessed Lamb of God. Father God, I lift up the men of this house right now. Raise them up to be mighty lions, Lord God. Father, that we would be the head of our homes, that we would not lord over our families, but we would be as Christ to the church, that we would learn to wash our feet, the feet of our spouses, that we would learn, Lord God, to wash the feet of our loved ones, Lord God, that we would never lord over our home, but we would serve our spouse. Father, I thank you that in this moment and in this season and in this hour, Father, I prophesy right now in the mighty name of Jesus that this house will be a healing house of marriages, Lord God. Father, raise up strong marriages in the mighty name of Jesus. Let us be examples of what it means to be Christian, what it means to be a spirit-filled believer. Father, I pray for holy, holy matrimonies, Lord God. Father, I even believe that when broken marriages walk through the threshold of these doors, that they'll be healed, they'll be delivered, they'll be set free because your glory is here. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. There is emancipation from bondages. Father, I thank you, Lord God, that this is a place where bondages begin to fall out of people's lives, Lord. Father, I thank you that you are doing a great and mighty work. Father, we dare to continue to believe for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Father, we don't want the traditions of men. Father, we don't want just programs. Lord, we really, really desire the move of the Holy Ghost. Father, not by might, not by power, not by intellect, not by philosophy, not by intellectualism, but by the Holy Spirit, Lord God. Father, I pray that you would raise up men to be men, men who worship, men who are not ashamed to shed tears for you. Raise up a spirit of David among the men. Father, that we would learn to be priestly priests in our homes and our households. Father, we just thank you for that, Lord God. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Man, I thank you for the spirit of renewal. I thank you for the spirit of reformation. I thank you for the spirit of not just revival, but outpouring of the Holy Spirit. We want to see your glory, Lord. We're here because we're hungry. We're here because we want to seek your presence. Mark us, Lord, to be a people of the glory of God. Cause us to burn brightly. Father, I pray that you would begin to shift the perspectives and the perceptions and the filters of the people of this house, that the one that's called to the ministry is not the one with the microphone, but the one that is called to the ministry is the one that's sitting down right now. Father, that you would raise up the body of Christ to be equipped and mobilized to do the work of the ministry. Father, I thank you, Lord God, that there are teachers and people that work in secular jobs. Father, I pray for an evangelistic anointing to fall over them, Lord God. Father, the Spirit of the Lord and the call of the ministry is for the entire body of Christ, not just the preacher, the pastor, the evangelist. It's for the whole body. So, Lord, we want to see that. Father, we continue to pray for the multiplication of the souls. We want to see souls saved. We want to see people's lives rededicated. Lord, we want to see divine healings. Father, we agree for miracles in the name of Jesus. Father God, we want to see true, full-blown deliverances, Father God. We want to see generational bondages broken. Lord, and most of all, above all, we want to be in love with you, Lord. We want to be first love lovers of your presence, Lord. Lord, I pray that you would put over us a spirit of repentance, a spirit of conviction over us. Father God, that we would walk worthy of the call that you have called us for. We love you, Lord. We honor you. We shake off the busyness of this week. We shake off the apathy of this week, Lord. And we put on the new man who's recreated in Christ Jesus. Father, we declare what the Word of God says, that before the foundations of the earth, Christ was crucified, and that you have destined and ordained the perfect will of God in front of us. Father, I thank you that all of us collectively and individually would walk in the highest call of our lives, that we would never walk in the permissible will or outside of the will, but we would walk in the perfect will of God for our lives. Father, I thank you, lastly, for the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the deep and intimate knowledge of you. Lord, we don't want just a Bible lesson or just a facts and figures about scriptures, although those things are good. Father, we ask you that the God of glory would unveil the Word of God to us and be transformed. Father, we declare 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, we with unveiled face, beholding as in a glass, which is your word, your glory, are being transformed into the same image that we're beholding from one degree of glory to the next. For this comes by the Spirit of the Lord. And so we thank you for true transformation. True transformation by the Spirit. We thank you, Lord. We give you glory. We give you honor. We give you praise. How many of you believe that God hears us when we pray? How many of you believe that he just heard these prayers? I'm going to tell you something. You don't have to pray, if it be thy will, heal me. If it be thy will, deliver me. If it be thy will, send your spirit. If it be thy will, send revival. No, it is God's will. So come into agreement and come into alignment with the Word of God and walk in it. Amen? So, Father, I just thank you for that. Jamie and Kara, you guys are heading out, right, somewhere? Come on, let's pray over you before we wrap up intercession time. Now, you guys are heading to where? Okay, that's a lot. Virginia, Scotland, Iceland, Ireland, England, and D.C. Come on. All right. Let's together stretch forth your hands to them. Amen. Father, we just lift up the Mots to you right now in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you that they are marked and they are sealed. Jojo, can you put your hands? I want you to take oil right there and anoint their feet. Father, I thank you, Lord, that you would anoint their path. I thank you for your hedge of protection over them. And I ask you, Lord, that you would use them in great power. Father, that when they preach the gospel, that signs and wonders would occur. I thank you for deep prophetic insight and prophetic unction to begin to take place. I dare to believe that they would begin to jump from one function to the next, that in one moment they'll be shepherding, and the next moment they're prophesying, and the next moment they're evangelizing, and the next moment they're mobilizing. So, Father, I thank you for that. I thank you for the fire of God and the glory of God, that they would go in the submission of the Lord Jesus. Father God, we bless them. We as a church body bless them. And we know they are submitted under your authority. And because of that, Satan will flee. The devils will flee. And whatever they set their minds to do, Father, they would prosper. So, Father, anoint them and everywhere they go. And we thank you for great testimonies. I expect to hear miracles. I expect to hear testimonies of great power being released. And Lord, I also pray that you would do something with them specially as well. Just as they're given out, I pray that you would give in to them as well by the Spirit. And I thank you. I'm going to tell you what the Lord told me a week ago, and I just believe it for both of you. This is the time for overflow, you know, that you're not just going to give what you have, but you're going to give out of the abundance of the overflow. When something is in overflow, it gives, but it never, when it gives and gives, it doesn't deplete. And so I just declare that both of you are walking in a state of overflow, and that you're giving as fountains of living water. And so, Father, we thank you for that. Seal them with your protection. Seal them with your grace. We just thank you for that in the mighty name of Jesus. And everybody said, the church said, amen. Praise God. All right. Praise the Lord. Well, we're going to spend some time in worship. What's up, brother? I'll talk to you soon. We're going to spend some time in worship. And I just want to encourage you, if this is your first time, this is House of Glory. Our slogan is church not as usual, because it's not as usual. Amen. So let's stand up. Let's reverence the presence of the Lord. If this is your first time, hello, welcome. If this is your second time, welcome back again. The first time you're a visitor, the second time you're family. Amen. Amen. I got my dear friend John Lopes and his family there. How many of you remember that testimony that I gave, that I was preaching the gospel in this little blue truck, and I had a really crazy Brazilian friend that laid hands on a handkerchief, and this lady took it. Her brother was sick, dying in the hospital. They took that handkerchief back to Puerto Rico. She laid hands on the brother. The brother was healed, and they had church services. Who remembers that testimony? You remember that? That's the guy right there. That's the man right there. So you don't think I'm lying and making stuff up. So John, we love you. Diani, we love you. All of your children, we love you. So let's get ready to worship. Amen. And brother, God bless you from Tennessee. Come on, brother. Come on. The Lord's going to bring mobilization. He's going to bring expansion, and he's going to bring a territory of expansion. Get ready to not be used to what you understand. You're not going to be in the same spot for long. You're going to be doing this number here. God's going to use you greatly in miracles and evangelism. But it's going to be even greater. Now is the season for mobilization. Let's worship the presence of God.
Walking up and down these aisles. Come on, church, sing this with me. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Hallelujah. Come on, just begin to lift your worship up to the Lord. I sing praises to your name, praises to your name, a name that is so much higher than all names. Hallelujah. There's freedom in the name of Jesus. All honor to your name. All honor to your name. The name that's so much greater than all names. Come on, sing, be lifted up. cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands and feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound, entrenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name. Yeah. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forever. For endless days he will see your praise. Oh, Lord our God. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forever. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord our God. Oh, praise. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord our God. Oh, praise the name. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will see your praise. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord our God. Woo.
Come on, just lift your hands to him. Give him your worship. Oh, you're worthy of all glory and honor. Jesus, we worship you. We worship you. We lift up our songs to you. Oh, we worship you. Come on, just begin to say the name of Jesus. 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 There's power in the name of Jesus.
Of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trample death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King.
Hey!
He shall return in robes of white, the blazing presence in here today. Don't you feel it? Oh, I feel the freedom of Jesus. Has he set you free from the power of sin and shame? Oh, the blood of Jesus has washed it all away. Hallelujah. Sing, I will give you all my worship, and I will give you all my praise. You alone I long to worship. You alone are worthy of my praise. I will give you all my worship. I will give you all.
Praise the Lord. Wow, what a wonderful
just rich sense of the presence of the Lord is in this place. May we never take that for granted. Whenever he comes, whenever he walks in the room like that, may we always bow in reverence and thanksgiving and awe. That melody, I feel like that's a like a song of the Lord over us tonight.
Oh, 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 oh.
There are songs and melodies that when you begin to sing them, it's like a doorway between the heavens and the earth begins to open, because the worship of earth is coming into synchronization with a worship that surrounds the throne. Sing, worthy, worthy, worthy is he. He alone can open the scroll. He alone can break the seal. Only he is paid with his blood. Hey! Come on, lift your hands. Lift your hands. Jesus. Jesus.
Can we just sing that out to him? That little melody? Just the voices? Let's just sing it out to him. Go ahead, it's okay. Simplicity of your heart. Look to him. Say it again. Still, we worship you, Lord. We thank you so very much for your presence. We can experience your presence every day. We're so very thankful for the simplicity of loving you. I pray, Lord God, that you would make our hearts simple. As we exalt you, that's all we care about. We worship you, Lord. We look to you. When we don't know what to do or when we don't know what to say or what decisions that we need to make, we look to you. And as we sit in your presence, your power sits on us. And you stir us and lead us by your Spirit. We worship you. Fill us with new wine. Fill us with the light of your word. Let the pages of the scriptures just leap out into our very spirits. Let the word become living manna, bread, true meat. We thank you for your blessing and we thank you for the seal of your Spirit among us. We give you the glory today. Holy Spirit, open our ears, open our eyes, cause us to see your word in a new light. It's by your word that we're renewed. It's by your word we are transformed. We elevate your word, for you have lifted your word above your name. And so, Father, as the word goes forth, the ministry of the word, may the ministry of the Spirit begin to demonstrate your word. In the name of Jesus. Say this with me, church. I have ears to hear. I have eyes that see. The Spirit of God dwells in me. He's my teacher. And I know all things. In Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Now I'm supposed to dismiss the littles, right? If you're a little kid, you are dismissed with Miss Elizabeth. Hi, can you wave, Miss Elizabeth? This is our children's director. Amen. Praise God. Your littles are dismissed. Your littles are in good hands, okay? Amen. Praise God. Wow, what a beautiful time in the presence of the Lord.
Beautiful time to minister to God, right? You know what I love about the Lord? He's so simple. It's so simple, it's offensive. If we just simply minister to him, he simply ministers to us. The Bible says, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength, right? If you need renewal, you need reviving, you need strength, wait on the Lord. Yeah, but I need this. Wait on the Lord. Yeah, but my mind needs this. Wait on the Lord. Amen. When we wait on the Lord, we receive everything. Everything we ever need. He's the rewarder. Amen? So, today we are celebrating communion. Amen? And for those that don't know that, the first of the month? The first Sunday of every month, we do communion. And we have our love feast. Now, what on earth is a love feast? It's a big old Christianese word for we're just getting together and eating. And we're having a good time. We're just fellowshipping, you know? And so that's a biblical thing. And I think that we need to return to that. You know, the early church would have communion and they would have fellowship. And we need to return to that. You want to walk in greater unity? You want to walk in greater anointing with one another? Eat with somebody. Talk with them. Fellowship with them. And your life will be blessed. Amen? All right. Today, we're going to talk about the body of Christ. Say this with me. The body of Christ. What is it? What is it? What is the body of Christ? There are three things. Say this. Three. There are three things or three descriptions of the body of Christ in Scripture. Okay? And I want us to look at it. I want us to contemplate it. I want us to reflect on it. When we reflect on the truth of God's word, what begins to happen is that we reflect his very being. We reflect him himself. You are made in God's image. Or another way to say this, you're an imager of God. You're a big old giant mirror with the glory of God in front of it. That's who you are. And so in order to reflect God, you must reflect upon him and upon his word. Amen? So many people want transformation, but they spend little time in the meditation of the word. The meditation of the word is everything. When we meditate upon him, we are changed. Now, what is the body of Christ? There are three things. Say this with me. The body of Jesus himself. The body of Jesus himself. That's going to be the first description of what the body of Christ is. I'm going to give you a triune answer. Why? God is one. He's three. He's triune, right? So I'm going to give you a triune response so you can see this. First and foremost, the body of Christ is the body of Jesus himself. Turn with me to John chapter 2. I'm reading from the New King James. John chapter 2, and we're going to start in verse 13. And if you don't have your Bible, that's okay. Just listen, and we'll put it on the screen there. Now, the Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. And he found in the temple, say this with me, temple, those who sold oxen and sheep and doves, and the money changers doing business. And when he had made a whip of cords, he drove them out all of the, say this, temple, with the sheep and the oxen, and poured out the changers' money and overturned tables. Uh-oh, Jesus was angry. And he said to those who sold doves, take these things away. Do not make my Father's house a house of merchandise. And then his disciples remembered that it was written, zeal for your house has eaten me up. So the Jews answered and said to them, what sign do you show us since you do these things? And Jesus answered and said to them, destroy this temple. Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. Then the Jews said, it has taken 46 years to build this, say it, temple, and you will raise it up in 3 days? But he was speaking of the temple of his body. First description, what is the body of Christ? His temple. The body of Christ is the body of Jesus himself. But I want to show you something. He refers to his body as a temple. That's the first description. Say this with me. Jesus is the temple. He is the temple. Jesus is the temple. He refers to his literal body as this temple. Now, what on earth is that? Have you ever heard of this? My dad used to say this all the time. Take care of your body because it's your temple, right? We say this. Now, what is that? Is it some place where we go and sing and hum and sing these bells? No. Jesus being Jewish in a Jewish worldview, Jesus being from the Middle East in the place of Israel, Jesus, King of the Jews, was referring to the dwelling place of Almighty God. In other words, the temple is the dwelling place of God's glory. The glory of God resided in the temple. Say this with me. There are five. Come on. Are we on a funeral or are we celebrating Jesus? Is this House of Glory funeral center or is this House of Glory? Come on, man. There are five different types of foreshadows of temple. There's five of them. Okay, I want to show them to you. Now, the dwelling place of God's glory. First, let's look at the first one. Moses' tabernacle. Okay, turn with me to Exodus 40, 34 through 38. I hope you got notes because I got a lot of Bible to give you. Amen? All right. God forbid I preach the word of God in the church. Exodus 40, verses 34 through 38. I want you to see this. This is the first typology of the temple. It's the tabernacle of Moses. Verse 34. Then the cloud covered the tabernacle of meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. I want you to remember that phrase, the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Verse 35, and Moses was not able to enter into the tabernacle of meeting because the cloud rested above it, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Do you see that? Okay, look at this, verse 36 and 37. Whenever the cloud was taken up from above the tabernacle, the children of Israel would go onward in all their journeys. Anytime the cloud would lift and move, they would lift and they would move. Wonderful typology of the Spirit-filled life. Verse 37, but if the cloud was not taken up, then they did not journey till the day that it was taken up. Wherever the cloud stayed, they stayed. Wherever the cloud departed, they departed. Wherever the cloud moved, they moved. You see this? The tabernacle and the cloud, the temple and the glory were in one and the same place. You see this? Verse 38, for the cloud of the Lord was above the tabernacle by day, and the fire was over it by night, in the sight of all the house of Israel throughout all their journeys. See that? So that's the first typology of a temple. The first time we see this typology is in Moses' story. It's in Exodus 33. Moses cries out. He cries out. He says in Exodus 33, what will separate us from all the peoples of the earth if your presence doesn't go with us? And he says, my presence, the Lord says, my presence will go with you and I will give you rest. Moses had a revelation. What this made the people of God distinct from all the other nations wasn't how awesome they were. It was how the glory of God was on them. You see that? The presence, the glory, that was only given to the people of that tabernacle. And then we shift to the second typology, which is, say this with me, David's tent. Okay? Now, bear with me because I'm taking you somewhere, okay? 1 Chronicles chapter 16, verses 7 onward. I'm going to read this story of this second typology. On that day, David first delivered this psalm into the hand of Asaph, his brethren, to thank the Lord. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, call upon his name, make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him, sing psalms to him, talk of his wonderful works. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those rejoice who seek the Lord. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his face or presence evermore. Remember his marvelous works which he has done, his wonders and his judgments of his mouth. O seed of Israel, his servant, you children of Jacob, his chosen ones, he is the Lord our God. His judgments are over all the earth. Remember his covenant forever, the word which he commanded for 1,000 generations. The covenant that he made with Abraham and the oath to Isaac and confirmed it to Jacob for a statute to Israel for an everlasting covenant, saying, to you I will give you the land of Canaan and all the allotments of your inheritance when you were few in number, indeed very few, and strangers in it. When they went from one nation to another and from one kingdom to another people, he permitted no man to do them wrong. Yes, he rebuked the kings for their sake, saying, do not touch my anointed ones, and do my prophets no harm. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Proclaim the good news of his salvation from day to day. Verse 24, declare his glory among the nations, his wonders among the people. For the Lord is great and greatly to be praised. He is also to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the people are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Honor and majesty are before him. Strength and gladness are in his place. Give to the Lord, I love this, O families. Give to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Give to the Lord glory and strength. Thank God for that. Because the Lord is not just interested in me, myself, and I. He's interested in our families. Give to the Lord glory due to his name. Bring an offering and come before him. O worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. The world is also firmly established. It shall not be moved. Let the heavens rejoice. Let the earth be glad. And let them say among the nations, the Lord reigns. Do you see that? Keep reading. Let the sea roar in all its fullness. Let the field rejoice and all that is in it. Then the trees of the woods will rejoice before the Lord, for he is coming to judge the earth. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His mercy endures forever. And say, save us, our God of our salvation. Gather us together, deliver us from the nations, to give thanks to your holy name, to triumph in your praise. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. And all the people said, amen, and praised the Lord. Okay, so what do we see? We see the first typology, which is what? Moses' tabernacle, right? It was the dwelling place where God met with Moses and the people met with God. That was the first dwelling place. The second typology of the temple is David's tabernacle or David's tent. And for those that don't know what that is, David was the first really righteous king of Israel. The first king was Saul. The second king anointed David. And he did something kind of foolish. He dressed in his underwear and he began to dance clamorously foolish before the Lord and before all the people. And the Bible says that he began to give cakes and raisins to all the people. And some people hated him in their heart because he was a man of the presence of God. And for the first time in human history, we see that David opened up this tent that was similar to Moses, but it was 24/7 unrestricted access to the presence of God for the people of God. Do you see that? 24/7 access for God to the people of God. This is the second typology of the tent. I'm going somewhere. The third is the actual construction, Solomon's temple. I got a joke for you. Where is Solomon's temple located? At the side of his head. That was a dad joke, I know. Because the temple, get it? Okay. All right, moving on. Okay, 2 Chronicles chapter 5, verse 11 through 14. We see this. This is Solomon's temple. And it came to pass, when the priests came out of the most holy place, for all the priests who were present had sanctified themselves without keeping to their divisions, and the Levites who were the singers, and all of Asaph and Heman and Jeduthun and their sons and their brethren stood at the east end of the altar, clothed in white linen, having cymbals, stringed instruments, and harps, and with them 120 priests sounding with trumpets. This is the coronation service of the temple. Indeed, listen to this carefully, it came to pass when the trumpeters and the singers were as what? One. To make one sound to be heard in doing what? Praising and thanking the Lord. And when they had lifted their voices with trumpets and cymbals and instruments of music, and what did they do? Praise the Lord, saying, for he is good, his mercy endures forever. Something happened. What happened? That the house of the Lord was filled with a cloud, so that the priest could not continue ministering because of the cloud. For what? The glory of the Lord filled the house of God. Do you see a pattern between temple and glory? Do you see it? Watch this. Now, the fourth, that was the third temple. The fourth type of temple, say this with me, Herod's temple. Technically not really fully a temple, but really more of a reconstruction, okay? Now, the reconstruction of Solomon's temple was marked with merchandise, listen carefully, with mixture, okay, and corruption. You hear that? This fourth temple was marked with mixture. Not necessarily godly mixture. They worshiped the God of Israel, but there was mixture in their hearts. There was idolatry in their hearts. It was polluted with so many corruptions. Where do we see this? We see this in the very beginning, the opening scripture that I showed you. Remember? What was the opening scripture? When did this happen? When Jesus started walking in. Now, remember how I just told you that when the temple of God is present, the glory is there? Think about this mystery. When I read it, I was like, whoo, I'm going to have to chew on that for a little bit. Think about this. When the tabernacle was constructed, God's presence was there, right? When every time these temples were constructed, God's presence was there. In the temple of Herod, in a weird way, God's glory is still there because Jesus himself was walking in there. You think about that. He walks in there and he sees all of these corruptions and he says, what is this? There's that, there's this. He drives a whip, he whips them out. Oh, Jesus is nice. He ain't nice with sin. He ain't nice with hypocrisy, right? He's not nice with, but let me tell you something, he's patient. You know, the Bible says that he made a whip of cords. Jesus being a carpenter, that took him a while to make. It wasn't like fabricated immediately. I bet you he was working very patiently, just sitting there smiling. What are you doing, Jesus? Oh, I'm making a whip. For what? You'll see in a minute. See, when Jesus pronounces judgment, he pronounces judgment with purity and patience and perfect forbearance. He never lost his temper, because losing temper is sin. The Bible says the zeal of the Lord consumed them. There's a difference between anger and zeal. You see? And so Jesus pretty much whooped the changers out, right? Which leads me to the fifth temple. Can anyone guess what the fifth temple is? Oh, you're close. You're very close, but before that. The fifth temple is Jesus Christ himself. You know what's really interesting? The number five in the Bible is the number of grace. Isn't that interesting? And the temple that he hears Jesus going into the temple of Herod, and then he starts saying things like this. In 3 days, you know, you can destroy this temple and I'll rebuild it. He is the temple. Jesus is the divine overlap of heaven and earth. Jesus is a living temple, moving, breathing, walking. Jesus is the suspension between heaven and earth. Jesus is the Jacob's ladder. Jesus is that temple where the glory is. You want to see the glory, you look at Jesus. Watch this. John chapter 1. This is so awesome. If this doesn't get you excited, go fast and pray for a little bit until you get excited. John 1, verses 14 through 18. We're talking about the fifth temple. And the Word became flesh. Who's the Word? Jesus. The word "word" there is the Greek word logos. The word logos is where we get the word logic. It's where we get the word language. Jesus is the logic and the language of the Father. Jesus is the perfect interpretation of the unseen, invisible, uncreated God. And this Word became flesh. And say this with me. He dwelt among us. This Greek word is the same Greek word that means tabernacled. That Jesus became flesh. In other words, Jesus became a temple. Jesus clouded himself. He became a tabernacle among us. And watch this. Remember I said tabernacle and glory go together? What's the next thing that it says there? And we beheld his glory. Isn't that awesome? The glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness of him and cried out, saying, "This is he of whom I said, after he who comes after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. And of his fullness we have all received grace for grace." Five, grace. You see that? "For the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, who's in the bosom of the Father, he has declared him." This is the temple. You see that? Now, as I'm talking, I just got revelation just now. And it was Chris Watson's fault. Six is the number of man. The sixth temple is the church. Humans. Think about that. Oh, think about that. You and I are part of that temple. Are we not? Look at this. Now, that leads me to the second definition. So first things first, what is the body of Christ? The temple of God, right? What is the second definition of the body of Christ? Say this with me. Us. 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 Us individually and collectively, which leads to that point. Now, look at 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 18 through 28. Are we all good? Yeah. We're good? We're learning something? Yeah. Okay. All right, watch this. 1 Corinthians 12, verses 18 through 28. "But now God has set the members, each of them, in the body just as he pleased. And if they were all one member, where would the body be? But now indeed there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, 'I have no need of you,' nor again the head to the feet, 'I have no need of you.' No, much rather those members of the body which seem to be weaker are necessary. And those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, on these we bestow greater honor, and our unpresentable parts have greater modesty. But our presentable parts have no need. But God has composed" what? "The body, given greater honor to that part which lacks it, that there should be no schism in the body." Remember that. Remember this word, schism. "But that the members should have the same care for one another. And if one member suffers, all the members suffer with it. Or if one member is honored, all the members rejoice with it." No, what does that say? Come on, I want everybody to say this with me. Now, you are the body of Christ and members individually. Say it again. You are, say this with me, apply it this way. I am part of the body of Christ. Let's say it this way. We are the body of Christ, members individually. And God has appointed these in the church. First apostles, second prophets, third teachers. After that, miracles, then gifts of healings, help, administrations, and varieties of tongues. Are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, are all workers of miracles? Now, do all have the gifts of, okay, that's fine. Now, for those who are really interested in the gifts of the Spirit, in a few weeks, I'm going to teach on that on Thursdays. So it's going to be, don't miss that. Now, but that's not what we're focusing on. The reality is, the second definition of what the body of Christ is you and I. The word member is the Greek word that means a limb, a literal limb, like a body part. A body part of what? When we hear phrases like, hey, I'm speaking to this body here, we look at it from a symbolic kind of like symbolistic, metaphorical way. But in the New Testament, we are the body of Christ. We are members. We are limbs of his body. And so that is the second definition of the body. Now, let's look at 1 Corinthians 6, 17 through 20. Okay? Man, I encourage you to meditate on these things. I encourage you to read them. I encourage you to apply them. And when you pray, pray it out for yourself this way. 1 Corinthians 6, 17 through 20. Oh, I love this. One of my favorite scriptures. This scripture makes me dance, man. Because it's true. But he who is joined to the Lord is what? One spirit with him. Flee sexual immorality. Uh-oh! Yes. Flee sexual immorality. Every sin that a man does is outside the body. But he who commits sexual immorality sins against his own body. Or do you not know that your body is the temple? Come on, this is good stuff. The word is teaching us something. Temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own. For you were bought at a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Listen, let me tell you something. This is very important. I'm going to go here real quick. Many times we need to understand the severity of sin. Because sin defiles us. Because we're called to be saints. Because we're part of the body of Christ. You know, there's different ways. How many of you ever heard somebody preach like this? Don't do this. Don't do that. Don't do this. Don't do that. It's just legalism, okay? But what we need to understand is there are things that grieve the Holy Spirit of God. Sexual sin, sexual immorality, all of these things that defile us, they grieve God's Spirit. Why? Because we are truly the temple of God. And this is, that maybe today you're here today, and maybe you might be struggling in a mindset or a vice. You know what the best way to get out that is? Continue to see yourself as the body of Christ. Ask the Holy Spirit to give you revelation. Look at yourself in the mirror and say, man, I can't believe I just did that, but I am the body of Christ. And the Holy Spirit will do such a work in you that conviction from God will come and you will walk in a way that is pleasing to him. Not in the sense of legalism, but in the sense of a calling from the Spirit, because your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Amen? Lord, convict our hearts, convict our minds, convict our thoughts. This is not a condemnation thing. On the contrary, it's a come up higher thing. It's not you. It's, hey, baby, come up here, come up here, come up here. You're missing out on all this glory here. That kind of rhymes. All right. 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 12 through 15. John, your laugh is funny because it makes me laugh too. Yeah, Connecticut thoughts. All right. 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 12 through 15. Again, the second definition of the body of Christ is what? You and I, right? And us individually, correct? Now watch this. Here is Peter. How many know Peter the Apostle? Peter is writing his last letter. He's actually getting ready to depart and be with the Lord. And I want you to take note and pick up the language that Peter is giving to the church as a farewell, okay? See if you can pick up what Peter's dropping, okay? Watch this. Here's Peter. This is his last letter. He's about to die for the gospel. He says this, "For this reason, I will not be negligent to remind you always of these things, though you know and are established in the present truth. Yes, I think it is right. As long as I am in this tent or tabernacle, to stir you up by reminding you, knowing that shortly I must put off my tent or tabernacle, just as our Lord Jesus Christ has shown me. Moreover, I will be careful to ensure you that you have always have a reminder of these things after my decease." What did you notice there? Come on, somebody talk to me. Talk back. What did you notice there? And what was his body called? A tent. Do you see that? So we are, our bodies, collectively we're the body of Christ, but individually we are tents of his presence. That's who you are. That's what we're called to be. Do you see that? We need to have an apostolic revelation of that. I'm a tent. This tent's going to be put away and God's going to give me a new one. Come on, brother. And what is the tent? The house of his glory. You see that? All right. The third, we're transitioning. All right, who can tell me what the first temple was? The first definition of the body? Well, the three definitions I want to give you is Jesus' body, right? And then secondly is what? Us individually, collectively. And this also is the body of Christ. You're looking at it right there. What? Yeah. Yep. Let me show you. Matthew chapter 26, verse 26. The mystery of the body and blood. Say this with me. I am what I eat. I become what I eat. If that's true in the natural realm, if all you eat is ho-hos and cookies, you're going to look like Santa Claus. Right? If all you do is eat Pillsbury Doughboys, you know, Twinkies, don't complain. Right? You are what you eat. And in the same way, we are what we eat in the spirit. I want to show you something. Man, is this encouraging you? I pray so. Okay. Matthew 26, 26. Look at what Jesus is saying here. Oh, this is so powerful. Here's Jesus. He's with the disciples. This is his last time he really gets to sit down and eat a meal with his followers. He says this, "And as they were eating, Jesus took the bread." Chris, come up here. James, come up here. I want you to take that matzah bread, sir. And I want you to take that wine, sir. Come up here with me. I want you to see something. I want you to see a representation of this. You come here, and then you, James, over here. Lift it up right there. Watch this. Listen to the word and look. "And as they were eating, Jesus took bread. He blessed it, and he broke it, and gave it to the disciples. And he said, 'Take, eat,'" what? "This maybe is my body." Hypothetically, metaphorically, "is my body. This is my body." "Then he took the cup and he gave thanks and he gave it to them, saying, 'Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. But I say to you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it anew in my Father's kingdom.'" The third typology of what the body of Christ is the symbolism, the doorway, that his body is the bread and the wine. Now, I want to show you something real interesting. You see this funny-looking bread here? Okay? It looks funny. It almost looks like a giant saltine cracker, right? This is called matzah. Say this with me, matzah. Matzah. See if you can pick up what I'm dropping. The matzah is a special type of bread during Jewish celebrations, specifically Passover, right? I want you to get, listen to this. This bread contains no yeast, zero. In order to consume it, it must be pierced. There are little holes inside of it. There are stripes on the other end of it. Did you hear what I said? In order to consume this bread, it must have zero yeast. Yeast is a typology of sin. No sin, pierced, and striped. That's Jesus. The wine, what is this symbolic of? Oh, man. The first miracle that Moses performed, he turned water into blood. Water into death. Jesus turns water into wine, his first miracle. Joy, grace, and life are in the blood and the life of Jesus. In order for wine to be wine, the grapes must be picked, they must be pure, and they must be crushed. They must be completely pulverized. It's a process of pain. And there is the wine. That is the body of Christ. That is the mystery of communion. Stay with me, brothers. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 16 and 17. Let's turn there. Now, you know what I find really interesting? There is no other passage in the Bible. Look it up. Zero. None. The only time Jesus says the words new covenant, it's always in relationship to the bread and the wine. He says, this is the blood of the new covenant. You see? It's our seal. It's a sacramental reality, which means like it's a symbol, but it's more than a symbol. It's a window to experience him. This is the presence of Christ. This is not just, it's just a cookie thing and I just eat it in remembrance. Let me tell you something. The word remembrance, take this in remembrance of me, is the Greek word anamnesis. Anamnesis means to recall, to live as if it were happening. When you partake of this, you are entering into sacred space with Christ. You are literally reliving the mystery of the death and burial and the resurrection, the blood of Jesus. I have no words for it, and neither should you. It's called a mystery. Mystery. Amen? Okay. Now watch this. 1 Corinthians 10, verses 16 and 17. Here's Paul. He says, the cup of blessing, which we bless, is it not the communion, say this, communion of the blood of Christ? What does this word mean, communion? I want to break this down. The word communion is the shared exchange of thoughts and feelings on a spiritual level. Look up the Webster's definition of communion. It is the shared experience of thoughts and feelings and exchange on a spiritual level. In other words, what he's saying here, he says, the cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the thoughts, the life, the sharing of the blood of Christ? That when we partake of this, we are partaking in the communion of his blood. I have no words for this. We receive it by awe. Let me say something to you real quick. The moment you try to logically figure God out, you're not really worshiping God. If God doesn't provoke a sense of mystery and awe, you're really not worshiping him. Amen. Amen. Now watch this. Now here it is. Here's the next one. The bread which we break, is it not the communion or the shared experience of the body of Christ? And then look at how he takes that reality and then he turns it around to you and me. He says, for we... though many, oh man, are one bread, and we are one body, for we all partake of that one bread. In other words, the body of Christ consumes the body of Christ to become the body of Christ. You are what you eat. Come on, man. That's good stuff. If you don't get excited, go lock yourself in a closet and hum. Go spend time with Jesus. If you don't get convicted of that, come back 3 days fasting and come back and return. Get excited for Jesus. Oh, now in closing, get the little, I'm trying to be discreet. In closing, let's do this. Watch this. We must examine ourselves. Say this with me. I must examine myself. Examination is not a bad thing. It's a good thing. Every day we ought to examine ourselves. Now, that is not to be confused with self-loathing and condemnation. If you say to yourself, oh, I'm not good enough, oh, this, oh, that, that's not self-examination. That is condemnation. That is the accuser of the brethren. That is a lie from the deepest pits of hell. You can throw that to the pit of hell and turn around and walk away from that. But examine yourself as your motives, your thoughts. Ask the Holy Spirit, God, does your word stir me? Lord, does your word bring about faith in my heart? God, does sin make me, does it grieve my heart as much as it grieves you? Lord, is there anything in my life that is preventing me from experiencing unhindered prayer? Maybe in my marriage, maybe in the church body. This is healthy. We got to examine ourselves. Can I tell you something? Every day I examine myself. I always check, what is the motive of my heart? What are the thoughts? Like, when I said that, what was the motive? What caused me to say that in my heart? Or when I was with my wife and she said this and then I said that. And God, what was the thought and the intention behind that? See, that's called self-examination. And we ought to always examine ourselves. A man or a woman that does not examine themselves is foolish. And I'll tell you why. Because the Bible says, judge yourself, lest you be judged. I've seen people with a tattoo that says, only God can judge me. You don't want that, baby. You don't want that. The Bible says, judge yourself. In other words, discern yourself. Examine yourself, lest you be examined by God. It's not a condemning thing. You understand my heart when I say this? Help us, Jesus. All right. Now watch this. This is very unpopular in church, but we have to preach the full counsel of God. 1 Corinthians 11:17-34. You might say to yourself, oh, but it's just bread and juice. Really? Then let's look at the context of what Paul says here. Now, in giving these instructions, I do not praise you. Uh-oh, he's giving a tongue lashing at the Corinthians. Since you come together, not for the better, but for the worse. For first of all, when you come together as a church, I hear that there are, say that word, divisions among you or schisms. And in part, I believe it. For there also must be factions among you, that those who are approved may be recognized among you. Therefore, when you come together in one place, is it not to eat the Lord's supper? For in eating, each one takes his own supper ahead of others. One is hungry and the other one is drunk. What? Do you not have houses to eat and drink in? Do you not despise the church of God and shame those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you in this? I do not praise you. For I received from the Lord that which I have also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and he gave thanks, and he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper. This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do, as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. You know, proclamation of the gospel is not only in word, but in deed. When we proclaim the gospel, we preach it, but we also reveal it. We show it through the bread and the wine or juice or however you want to look at that. Verse 27. Well, I just thought it was just a happy little remembrance. Well, look at this. If that's true, if it's just crackers and grape juice, why does Paul say these words? Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. Let a man examine himself. So let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason, many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep or die. If it's only some outward ceremony, then why is that occurring? There's something mysterious that we don't have an understanding yet. It's a mystery that we just reveal, that's revealed and we receive by faith. Now, watch this. For if we would judge or examine ourselves, we would not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened by the Lord that we may not be condemned with the world. See, even when God judges us, it's never out of condemnation. He scourges us as children. Have you ever been rebuked by Jesus? Let me tell you, I can give you my limbs right here. You know how many times I've been rebuked by the Lord? Seriously. But when he rebukes us or judges us, it's never to shoo us away in condemnation. It's as sons. He treats us as his children, right? But what is the admonishment here? What is the warning? Don't eat this in an unworthy manner. Don't eat this just because. Eat this discerning yourself. Right? Now, watch this. Verses 33 and 34, and I'm going to give you the last thought. Therefore, my brethren, because of these things, what does therefore mean? It means it's there before. Therefore means everything that I just told you, now I'm going to give you why I'm going to say this. Ready? My brethren, when you come together to eat, wait for another. But if anyone is hungry, let him eat at home, lest you come together for judgment, and the rest I will set in order when I come. What is the examination here? How many of you have ever heard this before? If you grew up in the church, you've heard this. Be honest. You can't eat that in an unworthy manner. So what you think it is like, God, forgive me of my sins. I can't take it because I just sinned the other day. You've heard that? That's not the context of 1 Corinthians. The context is unity. The context is division. The context is I follow Paul, I follow Peter, I follow Apollos. The context is factions. That is not properly discerning the Lord's body. Otherwise, why would he say, therefore, when you come together, wait for one another? What does that mean? Wait for one another. Be in unity with one another. Prefer each other in the harmonious bond of the Spirit, in the love of unity. Don't backbite. Don't devour your brother. Don't look at your sister with suspicion. Don't look at your brother with resentment. Don't do that because you are not discerning correctly. You are the body of Christ. Next time you get jealous of your brother, you look at that man and you say, there is the body of Christ. Inside of that man is the Lord Jesus. When you look at your sister and you want to say something because you suspect something, you look at that woman who was covered by the blood of Jesus. That is a woman that has the Holy Ghost inside of her. Don't do it. Don't. That's the context. Does that make sense? So, the examination is over division and unity. See that? Why? Because we have one body going back, and then I'm done. And then we're going to do this together. We're going to eat and drink unto the Lord, and then we're going to have a happy, jolly time, and we're going to eat as much as we can afterwards, okay? Oh, glory to God. Let me just find, look at this. I can't find it. Oh, there it is. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Let's look at it. Think about this. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 17. We're going to have this up on the screen the entire time. Just for the next 10 minutes. For we, though many, are one bread and one body, for we all partake of that one bread. That's a mystery. We, though many, are one bread and one body, for we all partake of that one bread. For though we are many, are one bread, that together we may partake of the one bread. You see that? Isn't that glorious? Isn't that beautiful? Amen. Praise God. Let's stand up. We're going to respond this way. You could put, if you want to put it over there, or you can eat it if you want. No, it's good. We'll put it back. This is what we're going to do. I want to, before I give the invitation for us to get communion, I want to make sure that I want to give two specific, very important calls, okay? First of all, I want to say this. The body of Christ is for every believer. Notice I said believer. Amen. For all. Now, you might be in this room and you may not know Jesus. Well, guess what? Today's your day. You can know Jesus for yourself. And once you're in and you receive Jesus, then you can share and partake because we're the body of Christ. So I want to give a bold a call, okay? I don't want to use the words with every eye closed and head bowed, because Jesus had his eyes wide open on that cross. He bled naked, full of pain. And I just want to give a bold invitation. If you are here today and you do not know the Lord, you don't know him. Maybe you grew up in church. Maybe you have an appearance of understanding of church, but you do not have relationship with Jesus. You've never asked the Lord to come into your life. Can I tell you something? He doesn't come here and shoo you away. He doesn't do that. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son. He loves us. He loved us so much that he sent his only son. If you're here today, I don't know. I don't want to make assumptions. And I feel convicted every Sunday we need to make altar calls on salvation. If you do not know the Lord Jesus, and even if it's the same people, we're still going to do it in faith because you never know who's going to come. If you don't know Jesus as your Savior, if you do not know him, you don't know him. Let me ask you a question this way. I'll say it to you this way. If you died right now, do you know where you would stand? Well, I think I'm okay because I'm a good person. Wrong answer. We're not saved by our righteous deeds. We're only saved by the knowledge of Christ. No one cannot come into the kingdom unless they are born again. You can't even see the kingdom of God unless you're born again. You know what that even means? It's almost like explaining colors to someone that cannot see. What happens is when we are not born again, we don't see him correctly. We don't hear him correctly. And if that is you today, I want you to be brave. And I want you to slip up your hand and say, you know what? I'm going to humble myself. I don't know Jesus. I would like to know him today. If that is you, would you slip up your hand? I'm going to give this some time. The second thing I want to say, when I say no Jesus, I'm saying you've already received him. What I'm saying is, like, you've received him. You've never received him. The second thing I want to say this. Maybe you're here today, and I'm not going to slip you up to the front. I'm not going to do that. We're just going to pray right there, because then we're going to celebrate communion together. The second call is this. You have run away from the Lord. You at one point knew him, but you've kind of backtracked, you've backslid. When I say backslide, I'm not talking about, oh, I backslide for a week. I'm not talking about that. Don't let Satan condemn you. I'm talking about you've lost your way completely. You at once knew the Lord Jesus, but you no longer have that fellowship like that. If that is you, be bold. Slip up your hand, and we will pray for you. Why do I do that? Let me explain. The Bible says, he who confesses me before men, I will confess before my Father in heaven. He who denies me before men will be denied by my Father in heaven. And we've got to make, kind of like this. Let me show it to you this way. When you get married, you don't get married privately. You get married in the public with the testimony of many witnesses. We're being married to the Lord Jesus. If that is you, you've gone your own way. You fell your own way. Maybe at one time you knew him and you just totally backslid. You don't even love the Lord anymore. That's you. Slip up your hand and we will pray. Together we'll pray over you as a church family. Okay. So everybody's here is saved, filled, and sanctified. Okay. Now, we're going to celebrate communion. So I'm going to give it to you, and you're going to help me. Because the gift of administration is not my gift. How are we going to do this?
Okay.
Here you go. Okay, what, Jose? Okay, so...
Yes.
Go ahead.
So what we're going to do, we're going to have Chris and Kristen come up. And the right side's going to come to Kristen. The left side's going to go to Chris. And we're going to start from this corner. We're going to start from this corner. And everybody's going to come make a line and grab communion. So you can, okay? And as you do, just make your way. We can put some...
I did not know that.
Yeah,
which
I
one?
Just, I was going to let you talk. Oh,
where is he?
Behold the Lamb upon the
cross. Okay, guys, we have a brother that wants to give his life to the Lord Jesus. Amen.
The sins of all.
So we're going to pray together, and we're rejoicing over you. Amen? So watch this. I didn't see him because I was over there. Let's pray this prayer together as a family. Can we do that as a family? Just as a family. Father, I want you to pray this prayer. Father, I come before you today. I acknowledge my sin. We all suffer. So Lord, today I confess. Make you the Lord of my heart. Wash me. Cleanse me. Forgive me of my sin. I receive Jesus into my heart. I believe you died on the cross for me. You are my Lord and Savior. Jesus. Now I'm going to ask you a question, brother. Okay? Don't worry. I know it's kind of shy. I get it. Okay? But I'm marrying you to Jesus right now. Okay? So let me just say this. Let me just say this to you. Do you confess Jesus as your Lord? Okay, do you believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sin? Do you believe that on the third day God raised him from the dead? Amen. Praise God. Amen. All right. Now you can eat. Go ahead. Praise God. Now, I know you guys must be hungry, but don't eat it yet, okay? We're going to eat it together. Beautiful day today. Isn't it a wonderful day? I'm so glad to be able to just celebrate with wild, zealous Jesus lovers. Yes. This is a place where you don't have to worry about shutting up or anything. You can praise Him. Yeah. Let me tell you something real quick. I'm a big fan of early church history. They used to call this celebration the Eucharistia. And that is it is literally translated as the great celebration. It's not something somber. Yes, we reflect on the painful death and burial and resurrection of Jesus. I can't drink all of that. I'm just I'm on keto. I can't do it. You know, I got to be careful. So listen. It's a celebration. Let me tell you something. I'm gonna say this to you. If you need healing in your body, you can be healed by consuming this. If you're tormented in your heart and your soul, you can get delivered eating this. Why? Because you're consuming Christ. Amen? Praise God. Okay, let's lower down the music. We got all our stuff, all of our things, all of our... Jesus, I love you. Now, let's just... sit here and just reflect. Listen to these words. Matthew chapter 26, verse 26. And as they were eating, Jesus took the bread. I want you to lift up this bread. I want you to look and behold this bread. Notice how it's striped. Notice how it's pierced. It's for you. It's for me. None of us are worthy, but He made us worthy. Come on. And He said, and He blessed it and broke it. You can bless it. What does that mean? Just bless the Lord. Praise Him. Break it. In your own way, bless Him. In your own way. Thank you, Lord. He blessed it, and He broke it, and He gave it to His disciples, and He said, take, eat, this is my body. You may eat the body of Christ, body of Christ. Think about how His body was shredded. His body was striped and pierced. Man, for our sin, our shame. He whooped the devil's certain word that I'm not going to say right now through the cross. The Bible says He disarmed principalities and powers on the cross. Think about by His stripes you are healed. You're delivered. Say this, I'm healed.
I'm healed.
I'm saved.
I'm delivered.
I'm delivered. Because of that broken body, this body is made whole. In Jesus' name, I feel the anointing on that. Then he took the cup, lift up the cup, body of Christ, and he gave it to them, saying, drink from it. Not yet. All of you, not some of you, not the ones who think they're worthy or good enough. All of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many. For the what? Remission of sins. Father, thank you for the precious blood of your Son. Your blood washes me clean. I want to sing this together. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is that flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. One more time. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Drink of it. There's a song that it will never lose its power. How does that song go? Please sing it. Mountains, lowest valley. Think about the blood as we're singing this. Blood that gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power. Never lose its power. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Sing it again. Come on, rejoice. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Jesus, thank you, Jesus. Last phrase here. You are worthy.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
Father, we thank you so much for your Son. We thank you for the body and the blood of your Son. We thank you for how kind and how gracious and merciful you were with each and every one of us. We thank you that you loved us so much that you would not leave us, that you would send your Son to pay the ultimate price. We do celebrate our salvation today. We do celebrate your love for us today. And Father, I just speak a blessing over the entire congregation now. I just say, may the Lord God bless you all. May he keep you. May God cause his face to shine upon you, be gracious towards you, and give you peace. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. We also want to invite each and every one of you to join us as we exit, as you feel ready. Don't nobody rush out if they don't want to leave for sure. But as you are ready, you can go out and to the right over to the Connection Center and join us for food and fellowship. Also want to give you the chance to give, to sow a seed. We give because he first gave to us. And giving is an absolute act of worship and obedience to further the kingdom. So there's ways to give. There's a text to give option that we have that's on the screen right now. 555-903. If you text that to 801-801, you can give just right from your phone. You can go to the website, houseofglory.org/donate. Cash envelopes are in the back. And if you write a check, write it to Father's Glory. And then in the memo line, put House of Glory. Okay? I also want to say one more thing, too, is that we had one hand raised in here today. It means everybody here is born again. There's many that are not born again. So I just would encourage you this week, invite somebody. We're going to give an invitation next week, and we're going to see hands raised because each and every one of you are going to invite somebody to come. God's will is that none would perish. And we will take upon us that kind of compassion and that determination to get over ourselves and out of our shells and invite. So let's see some new faces next week, some hands raised. And the Bible says that all of heaven and Father himself rejoices over one sinner that repents and over the 99 that don't. So we celebrate our brother today that gave his life to Christ. May God bless you. Yes. And so we love you all. And like I said, as you feel ready, just join us next door.